I can't believe how much I miss all of you, seeing you. There's it's great to be on Zoom, but I really do miss seeing you guys. So thanks for being here. The first thing I think we want to do is approve the minutes. Have you all had a chance to read them? If you have, somebody want to make a motion to approve them?
Move to approve.
Is there a second?
I'm not on the committee. I hate to. I forgot.
Yeah, you don't get to move.
Looks like Pat's going to have to move then, doesn't it?
Well, it's just me and Pat then. So
I think you can do it by consensus. The two of you can vote.
Okay. All right. Let's. Do you agree, Pat, that we can approve those?
Yes.
Okay, great. Well, then they are approved. So the next thing we're going to do is to look into, I think Nora and maybe Angie are going to update us some on the General Assembly legislation. And there's really quite a lot there. And some of it also is repetitive, but it just, when I read over all of that, I felt like, oh my goodness, this is kind of overwhelming. If you would like to take us through anything, Nora, that'd be great. And then let's think also about what kinds of things we need to talk to our legislators about. And I would personally like to, if we can work this out at some point, it would be nice if we could actually have another meeting with our delegation. But I don't know how meaningful that might be in that, I guess, that they're in a short session this year, but we can talk about that if the others think that that's something we should do, since we never really did go over our legislative agenda. We just basically talked about our needs as related to COVID. So Pat, what do you think, and others?
Yeah, for my part, I think it's anytime you have connectivity with the legislators is a good thing. And albeit not in person, it's not as personable, but I think it just shows you, out of sight, out of mind, they say. I think where if we're engaging them and really emphasizing, even though it's virtual, can only help us. So that's my two cents. I think you're right.
Okay. So Nora, is there certain things you wanted to point out in some of this legislation?
Sure. There's a couple of things I can point out while we're waiting. Oh, Angie just joined. Okay, great. And then Angie joined the call, and Byron's on the call now. Hi, Byron.
Hey, Byron.
Hey, good afternoon, all.
Good. So I think the most helpful document in your packet is basically that this is an informal overview, but it was prepared by the Large District Consortium, which is the group the superintendent and other superintendents of the larger districts in North Carolina belong to. And it gives you a pretty good rundown of the different legislative items in the initial COVID Relief Act summary. It also, you'll note, includes one of the things I would point out is that it includes some changes to the calendar law and asks school districts to start on August 17th. Does allow for you to use 5 remote days potentially, or to use instead of inclement weather, use remote days. So base, and then also adds 5 instructional days to the calendar. We will be bringing a proposal to the board, and I think the work session that's being scheduled on the 28th will focus on those calendar changes and options. So I don't know that we have to go into a lot of depth now, except that clearly the state is trying to prepare for the idea that one, you're going to be trying to mitigate against learning loss by having more instructional time, and two, trying to provide some flexibility regarding remote learning to be able to make up for lost learning that might happen this coming year if we get surges in the pandemic, which I think a lot of the public health experts are predicting. So you'll see calendar options coming forward to that. I do want to note, in case you get asked by any teachers, though, the way the law is written requires us to do that within the current 215-day teacher contracts. So the state did not allocate more funding to pay teachers for five more instructional days. They're saying basically take some of the work days that you use for professional learning or professional development and other purposes, grading, other purposes, and turn those into full instructional days, plus identifying some remote days on other teacher work days that you may have. You know that we've been trying to invest more in professional learning as part of our transformation strategy for our schools in the district. So, we'll lose a little bit there. The other piece on the early and middle colleges, those under cooperative innovative agreements have some exemptions from this new law. However, you've probably seen some of the news coming out from some of the universities about how they're amending their schedules in anticipation of different scenarios. Like they might start online, or they might start on time, but they're going to skip Thanksgiving and just end the year earlier than normal and skip some of the breaks, I think, just to try to get things done in a more compressed period of time. That will certainly impact our kids and our calendars for those non-traditional schools. And then you'll recall we also have restart dollars that we've been looking at, that flexibility to extend some learning time from kids. So that'll, don't want to preempt the discussion with the full board at the work session, but looking at all the ins and outs of the legislation is, and then presenting the options to the board is what that will focus on. So that's that piece. And I know Angie, I think, has some information she can share on some of the financing regarding some of the other COVID Relief Act summary and the county bill. And Jill has looked at that as well. And then we can also talk about sales tax legislation in a minute. So Angie, do you want to hop on and talk to them about sort of funding streams we're looking at?
Sure. So I'm just going to share my screen real quick to show a spreadsheet that I put together for the funding that districts are that's available to. I can't wait a minute. Hang on just a second. They're working on it now to allow me to share my screen. The first thing that's on the agenda is the question about the. There we go. Okay. All right. Oh, there we go. Yes, I got it. So this is just a spreadsheet that we put together very quickly to show the dollars that are available to school districts. The first is what we got in early April, I believe. It may have been late March. And it's the $50 million that the governor when he declared the state of emergency, these are dollars that were made available for school districts. The source of these funds is the reversion of the last year's summer reading camp, this year's summer reading camp dollars, and then some dollars from the state of emergency response and disaster relief fund. Of this amount, $50 million, Guilford County Schools has got just a little less than $2.4 million. And these dollars have to be spent before June 30th, 2020. As you can see, the purpose of these dollars is for additional expenditures related to school nutrition, childcare, remote learning, and sanitation. So clearly we've got a lot of opportunities to spend these dollars. The second line shows the CARES K-12 Emergency Relief Fund, and this is the $396 million that came directly to school, that is coming directly to school districts through GPI. This is the 21 to $22 million that's coming to Guilford County schools that we've talked about in federal funds. This is where these dollars are coming from. In House Bill 1043, the Coronavirus Relief Fund, and this is where on the agenda where it asks the question about the Senate bill or the Senate funding, this is where ultimately that ended up. So, you know, the Senate did a version, the House did a version, and then they ended up with House Bill 1043. These are federal dollars that are coming to the state for K-12, and you can see here how ultimately in House Bill 1043, the dollars were spent. You can see that $75 million of it's going to school nutrition. Those are dollars that we'll be getting in early June, I think once they're approved by the state board, but they have to be spent by June 30th. So we'll be moving some of our dollars that we're spending now into that fund. So whenever we figure out what our share is going to be, there's $70 million in summer learning, $10 million in contracted mental health, and $35 million in devices. And those are the dollars that will be eventually allotted to school districts. There are also other dollars that will be spent at the state level, and you can see that the $660,000 from residential schools and down, those are dollars that will be spent by DPI. So that's why you see the NA there in the allocation portion. For the other, the non-school nutrition dollars that are included in here, we have until December 31st of 2020 to have this dollar spent. And then finally, in the CARES Act, there's Governor's Emergency Education Relief Fund to support institutions of higher education and K-12 schools. We have not heard yet how those funds are going to be allotted. I don't know if the governor's waiting, what he's waiting on to make a decision, and if K-12 will get any of it, or if it's all going to be used for higher education. My assumption is, because these are federal dollars that came through the same CARES Act that we that our federal dollars did, that we'll have until September 30th of 2021 to spend those dollars. So this is the funding that we've gotten so far. I think when you look at this compared to what we received back in 2008, 2009, 2010, after the Great Recession, you'll see that this is a small percentage of what we received then. But this is what we have so far that we can address the needs of the district.
Angie, is it accurate to say it's about 10% of what we got during the Great Recession in terms of stimulus funds for public schools?
So nationally, that's what I've heard. I think that's what the number is. I haven't gone back and actually, you know,
calculated.
And you got to remember that in some of that stimulus money, it was, you know, used to supplant state money. So I'm not sure districts got the full benefit of all of that. But certainly, you know, these dollars are still a fraction of what we got then.
Right. So, you know, I think, and that's where the letter that was shared with the board previously came in from the Council of the Great City Schools, just pointing out that they're expecting this, the economic issues and then the expense issues side, to continue perhaps even longer than the Great Recession. And so that funding gap is a concern. So just something to keep an eye on, and something that might become an advocacy issue later, or, you know, even this spring as things move forward. Darlene, too, Mr. Gladden has his hand up. I don't know. I don't know if you can see that.
Okay.
So
I didn't, question. But go ahead, Byron.
Oh, no, I was just asking for the share screen, but Angie went ahead and did it to share. I don't know, Nora, if you have talking points, if you were looking at the first attachment. So I didn't know if that would have.
On the first one, I was talking through that first attachment. Mm-hmm. And then I believe it has all the major bill provisions and goes into pretty good detail. So.
Oh, okay.
Angie, can I ask you, when we talk with our legislators, what do you think is some of the most important things we need to share with them to make them doubly aware of our issues and needs.
Right. Well, I think, you know, clearly from the items that were already included in legislation, they feel like, you know, they feel like, I think we can see what they feel like are priorities for school districts, and certainly devices, certainly, you know, all the things that they funded ultimately are important. But I think the list that we sent, shared with you yesterday, I think that some of those operational things aren't things that legislators are thinking about, like how, you know, how, what we need to be able to start school back up, just, you know, the space issues, the, pull that list back up. I feel like I should know it by heart by now because so much, but,
the specialized filters, the right, sanitation equipment.
Right. Just the I mean,
yes,
the masks, the face shields, the online learning tools that we need. I mean, one thing to get technology into students' hands, but then we've got to have the resources in place when we, I mean, for the students to use, or the just having the technology alone, you know, not going to do us any good. But when we think about no touch bathrooms, I mean, that's a really expensive, when we talk about installing hand washing stations throughout schools. You know, that could be expensive. If we want every student back in school, we don't have the current facility space to do that. So is that bringing in portable classrooms? Is that, you know, trying to use outside space? You know, there's so many things, I think, operationally that legislators aren't thinking of, and school districts really, I mean, need help with that to be able to get kids back in school.
Well, let me add, I do have a question about like the faucets and everything. Mm-hmm. That's a huge number, 35 million, I think is what it was. And that's just one school district. So, I mean, is that something that's absolutely necessary? I've been seeing videos about what you're supposed to do if you're going to use a bathroom, a public restroom, and they kind of show you to use your arm or your wrist, or take a paper towel when you're turning the faucet on and off.
Yeah, and I think that's probably, you know, good for adults to hear and to be able to operate and do that. I'm not sure we can expect, you know, kindergarten, first, second, third graders to be able to do that. And I don't know that we would have the staff in place to be able to monitor that in the restroom. So, I mean, while I agree, I think there are some ways around it. And I just don't know that we can expect students of all ages to be able to do that.
I also have a concern about the time frame. We don't have much time to try to do all that.
Right. 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 Well,
so, you know,
are we going to talk about that? Are we going to talk about that list at our work session?
I think the work session is more to talk about the calendar.
Calendar.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I think as planning gets farther along, there'll be opportunity to come back and share more of that with the board. Although I think we are going to try to have some of the conversation about the different scenarios that we're having to plan for. You know, this is not going to be one plan. You kind of have to plan for multiple scenarios that could happen, whether that's everybody, you know, the ideal, which is you're able to open school with a minimum of fuss and support. That would be ideal. I'm not sure we're going to get there, but that would be ideal.
I think
kind of mix of online and or remote and also in person.
Yeah,
many districts,
I think Pat
are looking at phasing.
Pat has his
mm-hmm.
Pat has his hand up.
Okay.
Yes. Angie, is that a document you can that we can have access to that you brought up earlier?
The one with the funding, the one,
yes,
that I shared the screen. Yeah, we can share that, certainly.
Yeah, I think that'd be helpful for us to, for me, for my benefit, to look at the numbers and study those a little bit and, you know, really ultimately figure out where the legislative ask down the road may come from, or where we think we need to try to see where we might get more, or whatever it is. But that'd be helpful if I could, if I can get that list, I would appreciate it.
Yeah, I'd like a copy too.
I'll pretty it up.
Okay, and Byron has his hand up. Byron?
I did. I just realized that Pat took 20 years off with the beard. We didn't. We supposed to do that together, Pat.
Oh, that's right.
I was like, wow. I said, who is that guy? I said, okay.
Well, I did it. I was a sellout. Actually, I was a stand-in veteran for a commercial that's for a TV commercial this weekend. So I had to shave it off, you know, for a little bit of extra side money. So,
is that a haircut too?
Yes. Yeah, they needed a Marine, you know, that could still fit in their uniform or whatever. So I think everybody had was called in sick, or they just couldn't find anybody.
This location, yes. But I have an account. I'm an Uber driver.
But anyway.
Well, right, it looks good, Pat.
So my question was, regarding the estimate that we've done for with the, I think there's proposed legislation about the funding with that charter schools would impact our funding and what that could cost us in terms of federal dollars. Has that been reported to the state or part of the legislative report?
I think, I'm guessing, Byron, so I may be wrong. I think what you're thinking about is some concerns we have about how some of the CARES money will be distributed to non-public schools.
Correct. We spoke about it at our last meeting, and I didn't know. Okay. If we had.
That's a federal issue. It's by and large a federal issue.
Correct. But if that does happen and we're not able to stop that, to let them, you know, could the state, you know, let them aware this is money we're losing from the federal, if they could either potentially you know, offset some of that amount if we lose that battle.
Yeah, so I think Mr. Glenn's referring to the letter that was shared with the board that the superintendent signed on to from the Council of Great City Schools that was addressing that issue. I haven't heard anything more recently about that in terms of dollars or cents or impact. We know that that's something that they're continuing to track and look at. Have you heard anything additional to share on that one?
Yeah, well, so where it is right now is there's, you know how everything that involves the law is way more complicated than it should be, and this is one of those things. So there's timing and standing and jurisdiction issues about how to go about challenging the language in the guidance issued by Secretary DeVos and her group. And there's been both informal and formal discussions about how to go about that. And right now things are very up in the air because until the first dollar gets spent, there's some question about the best way to fix that. So I'll be on a call tomorrow to discuss it, but right now, the last I heard, there hasn't been a clear avenue to resolve it. Some states are following it. Some states are questioning it. And it's just all still too early to tell. But it doesn't look good for us. It looks bad. Looks like they will be sharing dollars across the board with students in non-public schools versus sharing them under a Title I type form.
That's based on their individual student poverty rate in the private
schools. Right. What their point is, or what they're alleging is that because public school kids share in CARES money regardless of status, so should private school kids. Because stimulus money isn't only going to poor kids. That's their argument.
Well, we sure follow a lot of rules on how we spend that money to make sure it goes to our poor kids.
Yeah.
I find that interesting. The other,
well, and totally unexpected to everybody that they right. use that logic.
Right. The other piece of legislation that's in this section that I wanted to call your attention to, I already talked about the revisions to state calendar law. There is in your materials that's highlighted in yellow, there's a, with some handwritten notes from Jill, actually, are a couple pages just on the calendar law. And the very last document we shared was a bill that just got introduced this week by Senators Robinson, Tillman, and Garrett. And this one is for the 0.25-cent sales tax, which potentially could be tied to used to help pay for a future bond issue.
No, it's Senate Bill 793.
Right. And we gave a link for you all for that. Like I said, that literally just got filed this week.
It's dated yesterday.
Yeah, it's pretty straightforward. I don't know. Angie, do you want to, are you still on the line? Yes. Do you want to talk to them about this one?
All right. So I think this is just the local bill that we talked about so that we could put on the ballot in November, on the ballot of 0.25-cent sales tax that gives the commissioners the authority to charge it. I mean, if the ballot vote would be approved, then the commissioners could or could not, they would be up to them whether or not they would add the 0.25-cent sales or implement the 0.25-cent sales tax. If you'll recall, I think the estimate pre-pandemic crisis, the funds that would be generated from this were about $18 million a year. They've recently expressed significant concern about their sales tax revenues since the crisis started, but again, they could designate these dollars for a specific purpose, specifically for public education, whether it would be for capital needs. They could, once bond issues are done and we no longer have capital needs, if that's ever going to happen.
That's never going to happen.
Right. But then there's also language, I believe, in this bill that would allow it to be used for things like teacher supplements or other things, still identified for K-12. That's kind of my take on it.
And I think one piece for GTCC is in there as well. So I think they had lots of discussions, my understanding, the chamber and other folks had lots of discussions about 0.25-cent, 0.5-cent, and felt this had the best option of passing. I think it's a good sign that there's was filed with bipartisan support. So that's a nice, I think there are a lot of ducks lined up to pass this, whether or not we end up having a bond in November or not. This would be
it also makes sense to me. To have one item on the ballot, because if you have the sales tax and a bond referendum in separate items, people will think it's one or the other. Whereas this, I liked the idea of this combined language. I think it's got a much greater chance of clarity with the public than having, do you want a sales tax or do you, because it's going to look like an either or if they're both supposed to be going to the same purpose. So I think this actually brings some clarity to the issue.
So that was the information we wanted to share with this group regarding the state legislation, unless there are any other additional questions. I don't know that there's any action that needs to be taken by this group or the board at this point in time, except I'm sure at the appropriate time, this group will want to support that legislation, which I believe when you look at your state, what you'd already approved for a state agenda, you'd had talked about having some kind of, you might need to do a vote to approve this legislation to advocate for it. That might be something, because we didn't have it when we did the state legislation. So that could be something we might need to bring forward to get the board's support of the legislative committee advocating for this bill. But it is something that we asked for. So I think that's it on the state section. If there are any other questions. Okay, and then the federal legislative items, I think Angie just went over some of those, and then Jill had, you all had asked her to take a look at federal dollars that were going to the county and what some of the stipulations were regarding those dollars. And I think, Jill, do you want to share that information?
Sure. There are virtually no there aren't any stipulations that would prevent the county from choosing to spend portions of that $93 million on school issues. Somebody said during the meeting, I'm just remembering vague pieces of that can only go to technology or can only go to, I think that was somebody's direction of what they'd be willing to spend it on, but there are no such restrictions in those dollars. They're there to respond to the COVID issues that arise in the community. And they're allocated to, you know, we're really lucky, actually. If you look at the dollars that are coming to North Carolina, there are only really three cities that got a big chunk. We're getting 93 million. Winston's getting six. So there's a big infusion in this county. And hopefully it's going to make a big difference. And hopefully some of it will go to helping us with connectivity and some of the other issues that we've talked about. There's been no determination or any declaration or anything by the commissioners at this point. So that's the other issue, is until we know what they're going to do, obviously we have to find out before we can do anything. So I think it's important for us to be working on spelling out our need.
They had a meeting where they did allocate a good portion of it. Maybe they haven't actually passed it in a meeting, but they had some meeting yesterday, I thought it was. And I think they were giving yesterday. Us maybe $5 million to Guilford County Schools. But they didn't allocate all of it. So I think there's something like at least 20 million left, or maybe it's more than that. I can't seem to find it right now, but they did.
I think the important thing for us is to clarify and spell out our need and put that clearly out there.
Yeah, we did that this week. They have that. They were all, each individual county commissioner was sent information that went to the board yesterday.
Would you also send that to me, Nora, so I have that as well? Thank you.
Sure. So right now we're looking at a fairly large potential gap between what we think we could end up needing and what we see coming down the pike in terms of funding. So obviously if funding doesn't come through, different adjustments would have to be made in some shape or form, which could also then impact our ability to on how many kids we can serve and safely open.
Right, and you'll know that while we're talking about federal legislation, now it's also a bill that passed the House for $3 billion, or $30 billion, I can't remember which one it was, but nobody thinks that's going anywhere, to be honest. That would also include a large infusion of cash that would be available to us, but don't think it's.
Right. So
is that the? I'm sorry.
Well, I think it said. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is that the? You're talking about Jill, the one in Congress that's the $3 trillion that's
the House, right? But
yeah, the kid. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, and the Senate's just not going to take it up.
Yeah.
From what I hear.
Yeah.
Right. So
okay, it says here they allocated, I think, 68 million of that 93 or 94. So,
great. I think the other thing the committee needs to think about is, you know, when you adopted your legislative agenda, which seems like years ago now, after all this pandemic, you adopted just the state section, with the idea that you'd come back later on federal, perhaps on federal issues. And I think just as Darlene raised the question of, you know, we primarily, when we met with legislators, focused on COVID-19, that seems to be the focus of the at the federal level as well, and probably will be for some time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I just need some guidance from this group as to whether you want us to bring forward federal items, or do you want to just primarily track these? Do you want to have it track these different bills and then see where we go from here? I guess I'm feeling like it's not a real useful exercise to gin up a lot of federal legislation we want adopted in the midst of a economic downturn and a huge pandemic, unless it's addressing one of those two issues.
Funding, well, it seems like they're not meeting. You're going to be hard pressed to even get them there other than to do the emergency stuff they need to do.
Right. So I'm not feeling or putting any suggestion that we need to go forward and adopt a federal legislative agenda just because we have in the past. We may just need to track these issues and talk about it and then take positions as bills come up, would be my suggestion. But it's not my call. I wanted to throw that out to the committee.
So Pat and Myron, you want to weigh in on that?
I mean, I'll take a stab at it. I think for my part, it almost seems like the only option really is to wait and see. I mean, for example, this $3 trillion bill that is really dead on arrival, because it's just full of, I mean, it's like the kitchen sink bill, you know, some people have called it, because it's got stuff in there that has nothing to do with, you know, recovery. So I don't know. I mean, I'm open to the pleasure of our chair on this, but I think we almost have to look at the legislation as it comes and then pick out what we can fight for. I don't know.
So for me, I struggle with certain parts of the bill. I'm kind of like on the lines with AOC. And you know, and some things that are pointed out with the bill, and I mean, there were, I think, 14 Democrats that didn't vote for it regarding the House. I do feel that we really can't afford to wait and see how the economy is going to surge by reopening, and you still have many Americans that haven't received their first stimulus check, and so the delivery of all of this has been a disaster. And so the fact that, you know, several million Americans have received their stimulus check, that the whole point of that was to stimulate, and it hasn't happened because they haven't got the money. So I do feel that a second bailout is needed, because the first bailout was delayed, you know, so long that they need a second one. But yeah, there are some challenges I have with that bill, though. I mean, it's not a clean bill. It is a lot to ask. But I do understand from a conservative standpoint that we need to see how the economy is going to respond. But we're also, you know, that could cost us more money to wait and see how much money we actually need to stimulate it.
Well, I think I'm not suggesting we wait and see how the economy rebounds, because that could be the first quarter of 2021, most economists say. I mean, the legislation that is coming out of Congress, for example, the $3 trillion bill, which has so much stuff in it that it's really not, I mean, in my view, serious, serious legislation. And it's really not about another, it's more of a, I would call it stabilization. I mean, if you want to call the first one a stimulus, or really the first one was more of a stabilizer, this would be real stimulus. Because so I think it's hard to, I don't know. I mean, I'm open to what you all think, but we almost have to see what authentic, legitimate legislation that reaches the compromise federally in Congress and the Senate. And then, but you know, it's not to say we can't advocate for certain things beforehand. I've never experienced this kind of thing, so I'm willing to learn and be open-minded about it.
I kind of think we should still have our own federal legislative agenda. Every year we've always had one. So my thinking is that we should have it, but you do need to take into account what's going on and be realistic in what you're advocating for. But personally, I think education spending should not be political one way or the other. So my thoughts would be that we would go forward with a federal agenda.
Okay. And it looks like not included. So I'm trying to put it in the chat if I can figure out how to do that.
Okay. And Nora, while you're doing that, to add to what Ms. Garrett is saying, I agree. School shouldn't be a political process, but the main pressure we're getting on reopening the economy is that if the schools are not reopening, then the economy really can't reopen. And so it becomes political. We're trying to push the economy back open, that the schools are going to be forced to open, in my opinion, prematurely. And, for those of you that didn't see the article, even with face shields and masks in France, that school developed 70 cases and had to close. And there was another situation in Sydney. So, I mean, the economy can't reopen without the schools opening. And so we've become a pawn. And I feel an experiment, open these schools so that people can say that they opened the economy, or that, I told you so, we shouldn't have. And I don't like the fact that we're gambling with the lives of our staff and students as a country.
Okay. I don't know why. I guess the chat only lets me put so much in at one time.
Well, we could take up the federal agenda at our next. We have a meeting
I can send it out to you. I've tried to post it in a couple of times, and it must have a word limit because it keeps cutting them off. So I'll send it in two, I guess. Do you guys see it in the chat, the first part of it?
Oh, I see.
This is what you'd had before.
Okay.
I've got one ask.
We should add that. I'm sorry to interrupt, Pat, but it just made me think that second bullet that talks about funding of Title I, you should say and use Title I guidelines for distributing all federal funds related to the, that's where you can backdoor the change that we'd like to see on that federal bill.
Okay. All right. So I had to
go ahead, Pat.
In two. So you have to kind of look at both Zoom chats. And I can send this out to you and we can talk about it at our next time. But what I see what you're saying, Jill, is adjusted based on the fact that we know that legislation's out there.
Right, and it's really guidance. Mm-hmm. The flaw isn't in the legislation. The legislation does distribute pursuant to Title I. It's the guidance from DeVos and her office that says to do it per student as opposed to per student as described in Title I.
Okay.
Yeah, one thing I would ask us to all be thinking about what the best pathway is, and that I think is really something we can achieve together, is wireless access for all students.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't know whether that's a state legislative ask where, I mean, even if we were to tack on a fee for registering your automobile, maybe it's a small fee for every automobile, and we use that money to help fund that. That's right in front of us, and I think that's really low hanging fruit given all that we've experienced with the access and problems, and that's across the country. So anyway, I would just throw that out there.
It's a good federal issue.
Yeah,
I've talked about it to several federal legislators that I've talked to. Is that
right?
Use connectivity like a utility. You're going to have a great divide.
Yeah, however we get there, I would just really want to see that as a priority, and we don't have to wait on anything in terms of current legislation or anything like that to be working on that. So,
sure. Well, we could certainly add that to this list of federal issues.
I think
the board would be supportive of that. And we've got lots of data about the need, so that's good. Okay. I know it's been probably, I think we last looked at the federal like November, December, January before all this hit. Is there anything else that you all would like us to make tweaks to before we bring it back for your review again?
Not that I can think of. What about you all? Tim, back? Your hands up.
We might be able to tuck into some of these other provisions stuff about that low wealth issue. So I'll look at that.
Okay. Angie, anything you think of from the different conference calls you've been involved in with the council and other people on finance?
So are you talking about the federal
legislation? Mm-hmm.
I can't think of anything more than you've already just, I think there are some things where we've talked about waivers, but I think that's probably a different conversation than to this group.
Okay. All right. And then I do think we would need to, I need to check the record. We may need to come back and get a vote on this tax legislation for the state, just so that you have the support of the whole board as you go advocate for that. So I'll double check and make sure it didn't get adopted and we just left it off, but I think we may need to add that. If so, we may bring that forward at the next meeting just to have that done, so you've got that piece done.
Okay. I think that would be good because of the timing that it's just been filed recently, and then we could take a vote to, you know, support that.
I think that would be appreciated symbolically, if nothing else.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea, Maura. So definitely.
Okay, good.
So we have a June meeting, right?
Yeah, maybe Kim, I'll turn her on here. She's got, there's a tentative schedule. We have a meeting plan for June, I believe. And then there's a tentative schedule with some new dates that we wanted y'all to take a peek at.
Yeah.
Kim, do you have that date, the next meeting date handy? I'm not putting my...
The next meeting date is June 24th on the agenda.
Yeah, that's what I was looking for. I was trying to get back to my agenda. June 24th is the next meeting, and then if you guys could take a minute in your packet and look at that calendar proposed for 2021, because after June we don't have any other scheduled meetings, and it tends to be a lot easier to schedule them in advance and cancel them if we don't need them than to try to round robin every month getting everybody together.
I say that sort of tongue in cheek, but remember this is a short session.
Right.
You might not need an August. You probably will, but you shouldn't.
Like I said, we can always cancel. Getting things that work with everybody's schedule is a bit of a nightmare. So
I bet.
Yeah.
We tried to stay within the same general pattern, and I believe these have been embedded with the superintendent's calendar as well.
Okay.
Certainly things pop up as well.
So Byron and Pat, are you okay with that schedule?
Works for me.
Yeah, I think it works.
Okay.
Well, at least the 2020. I'm unavailable for 2021.
Yeah, me too, Byron.
I'm to be determined on that.
Yeah, DVD,
somewhere. Yeah,
Oh Lord. Okay. So is there anything else we need to talk about?
I think amazingly, I know the agenda was sort of intimidating looking, but I think we managed to get through it all in fairly rapid.
Other business? Anybody want to talk about any other business?
Wait a minute. That's Anita. Oh, well, no, that's not really dealing with legislate. Well, let me ask the question. Would it be appropriate or something we would consider to, you know, kind of, I know we're already pushing with everything else about doing the census. I believe that, you know, if because of COVID, and I don't think they've done another extension for the census where they may be waiting to see, but to continue to push the census, because that's going to impact, you know, future legislative agendas in terms of funding if we have incomplete census for our district. So I don't know, maybe Dr. Carr can speak to like that, as far as are we still pushing that on top of everything else for families while they're home to complete the census so that we can have accurate numbers.
Yeah, we're still pushing that message out in a variety of ways and on a lot of channels. I think, you know, in talking to colleagues in other districts around the state, I think we're doing, you know, way more on that issue. And I think we have a lot at stake riding on it, and that's why we are. So we'll continue that. We will continue to push that out, and depending on what the deadlines are, when we know we'll probably be mailing the final report cards, it'll give us another opportunity to get that in people's hands, in addition to all the digital things we're doing and press information. So the county is moving up. We even have people making phone calls in some cases, and certainly doing everything we can to try to encourage families to participate. We're still lower than we'd like to be in our higher poverty and most significantly impacted neighborhoods, and where we have a lot of immigrants and refugees, and some of that I think is fear, and that's really hard to overcome.
Yeah. Okay, and to add, with the last thing I had is we may have already requested this, just not expressed, that for the additional funding, with because of this and the mental health impact and the number of cases, you know, because the number of cases of domestic violence has increased, as well as violence against children in the home that often go unreported, in terms of however it is we come back or to better help prepare reentry, you know, that we request funding, you know, or the flexibility within some of the categories of current funding to be able to move to employ additional mental health social workers, counselors, and things like that to, you know, to be a greater support to students and staff.
Mm-hmm.
Is that worded expressly in our current agenda, or is something we would add an addendum on federal and state to push that specifically for mental health?
I feel like we had something in there on mental health, but let me check real quick. We could certainly add it to the federal. Certainly we know all of those impacts in the, we already had kids dealing with trauma before, and now they're gonna have that in all these issues, and now they're gonna have the additional related to the pandemic. Let me see. Yeah, and your state agenda that you already adopted, you have increased allocations for school-based and community-based mental health personnel and services. And you could certainly put something to that effect in your federal legislation as well, if you all want to. Which I know multiple committee members have expressed support for in the past. Is that something that y'all would like us to add to the federal?
Sure. I think that's a good idea.
Yeah, I think it's going to be needed. I mean, and could we also add, I mean, I guess it was just asking, we're just putting it out there to ask for funding for for districts to be able to bring back a EAP option, employee assistance program in terms of, you know, mental support and communications, because I believe due to budget, we had to cut that program out. And so, you know, we, our staff are having to rely on, you know, their insurance and primary care doctors and referrals and all of that to navigate the mental part of the shutdown, as well as other things that were happening before COVID. But with an EAP program, that could be another resource. I don't know what the cost would be, or maybe something, depending on how the budget is, we may, with everything going on, we may be able to reinstate or to see if the funding, if it maybe have become more affordable because of all of this.
So are you asking, are you just suggesting that as something for us to consider budget wise, or are you suggesting that that's a legislative matter that we'd ask funding for?
Well, I think we've tied it in with asking funding. So that's to answer your question, yes and yes, to, okay, to for us locally to see, and then on a federal level, because if we're asking for the mental health counselors services for the students, we've got to look at, you know, we had staff challenges. I believe there was an estimate of somewhere between 20 and 30% on an annual basis, or we had staff out on, you know, medical leave, not necessarily specific to mental health, but we had, you know, a significant number of staff members at one point or the other out. And some of that may, I'm sure it may be connected to mental health. And if we, you know, particularly with not knowing how many teachers are going to, you know, come back and principals come back in the fall, depending on how we reopen, and some of them are not coming back at all, but hopefully as many that are feel comfortable coming back will come back. You know, we could, you know, that could be another resource to say that, you know, we understand the concerns and we're providing a resource here to communicate that as well as directly with the district.
Sure. No, that makes sense. I think you're absolutely right. The stress and anxiety of adults is going to have its own impacts just like it does on kids.
Oh, yeah. Good point, Byron.
I'm not sure the feds fund things like that, though. That may be state. We can look at that, but that seems awfully in the weeds for the feds.
Well, Jill, the weeds are all around. We're in the weeds. Why not ask? We're in the weeds already. Yeah. Oh, God. Such an unprecedented time.
Bless you.
Thank you.
That's all I have for the legislative. Dr. Carr, since you sit on both committees, I have a question. Is the policy committee slated to reconvene this month or next month?
Slated to reconvene this month. I think they, while we were dealing with all this COVID stuff, until we get a little farther along in planning and know if there's certain policy changes we need related just to this, just to the COVID stuff. So I'm not sure what the time frame is yet.
Okay.
I think we're not going to be meeting while we're sort of virtual, because we've kind of got our hands full at the moment with just dealing with all of this planning.
So. And upcoming graduations.
Yep, that too.
Oh, yes.
Yep.
Exciting.
Lots going on in a short period of time. So, but hopefully that committee, once we have a better sense of the district reopening and schools reopening, we'll then start convening at that time.
Good. Okay. Anybody else have anything else? If not, we can, if somebody wants to make a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
All right. All in favor.
I could only get away with it because Diane's not on.
You're funny, Byron.
I can only do it because Diane is not on. I'll get it in there. Oh,
good for you.
See you all. Our next meeting is the 28th.
Thank you, everybody.
All right, bye.
Oh, and if you all haven't responded to the...
To what?
No, for the 28th. They're wanting to know if we're going to... Yeah, they're moving it to 3. They're needing responses. Oh, why don't we just make a motion until further notice? We just go to 3 instead of asking every meeting, or do we want to go to 3? It's kind of like, you know, we just need to make a decision.
Well, if you want to do closed session first, make sure 3 is the time you really want to do it. You might want to do
2. Oh, we want to do it first. And I take it we're going to have closed session? Of course we are. So. probably have closed session every meeting. Okay. I'll go ahead and respond back to Lisa.
All right. Thank you.
Bye. All right. Thanks, everybody.
I hope not to be so blonde next time you see me.